Now we're going to use summations to help us find that exact area under the curve. So first we need to review summations. You should have seen this in your algebra class, college algebra, if you took it at Yuba College. And so here is, recall, sigma notation. We use this capital sigma. And that sigma here is telling me that we're going to sum. We're summing, basically plugging into our formula a sub k. We would plug in 1, and that would give us our first term a sub 1. We would plug in 2, that would into this formula a sub k, and that would give us our second term. And we would add until we got up to a sub n, the nth term. And I know we're going to the nth term because of on top of that summation is an n, and that tells us when we're going to stop adding. At this bottom where it says k equals 1, this is where we're starting our summation. Okay. So a sub k is the formula that gives us the kth term. So we can arbitrarily call k a number. So like I say, could find the third term by looking at k equal 3. And if I knew what the formula of a sub k is, I would plug in 3 wherever I saw k. K is just the index. The initial value is 1 and our ending value is n, like I said. So the basic idea is you're just substituting in the value for k into the formula for a sub k for k equals 1, 2, 3, all the way up until we get n, and then we sum them together. That was a quick review of that, what summation notation is. Let's look at maybe doing an example really quick using summation. Before we do an example, let me just recall or remind you some basic rules for sums and how to manipulate them. So maybe it's split up where you have your function is a sum of terms. Well, you can rewrite it so that one term is like one function plus the other term, which is like another function. And so we can think of this as the summation of the first term from 1 to n plus the summation of the second term from 1 to n. Same idea, if it was subtraction instead of addition, we can break it down so there's a subtraction in between the summation. If you had some coefficient in front, we can pull that coefficient out in front of the summation, figure out what the summation of a sub k is, and then multiply it by c. So for instance, if we're looking at the summation of 2x squared, I could look at pulling the 2 out in front of the summation and then taking the summation of x squared. Notice if you have some constant here, c, doesn't matter what it is, if you were looking at a summation of c from 1 to n, well, there's no variable in here. And so basically you're just adding c by itself n times, which is the same thing as c times n. Okay, so it says the first three rules are valid for any initial value and final value of the index. The fourth depends on the number of terms. Okay, so now let's look at an example of using summations. So our example is a summation from k equals 1 to 3. Our function is k minus 1 over k. And so basically our value a sub k, we can define it again as k minus 1 over k. And so what we're trying to do is find what a sub 1 is, sum it to a sub 2, and sum it to a sub 3. So whenever we see a k, we're going to plug in what our index is. And so a sub 1, this is equal to 1 minus 1, all over 1. Well, 0 over 1 is 0. So our first term is 0 plus a sub 2. So we're going to have 2 minus 1 over 2. Well, 2 minus 1 is 1 over 2 gives us 1 half. Plus a sub 3. So we're going to go in, plug in 3 wherever we see an x. And so we have, this is 3 minus 1 all over 3, which is 2/3. Common denominator would be 6. And so we could rewrite 1 half as 3 sixths plus common denominator, again, is 6. So we can rewrite 2/3 as 4 sixths, which would give us 7 sixths. Okay, so let's look at a couple more examples really quickly. Let's say that you're given some information about summations. You're given that if you looked at the summation of a sub k, where k starts at 1 and it goes to n, this is equal to negative 5. And if you have the summation from k equals 1 to n of b sub k, this is equal to 6. And we want to find the following values. So let's say it wanted, let's just do 1, the summation of k equals 1 to n of b sub k minus 1. So basically we're using our rules that I had given you before. So we can break this down. This is the same thing as the summation of the first b sub k minus the summation from k equals 1 of n of 1. Well, we're given up here what b sub k is. Summation of b sub k from 1 to n is 6. So this is 6 minus, well, this is telling me I'm summing 1 by itself 1 n times, which is 1 times n, which is n. Let me show you one more, just in case you get one of these summations and your value doesn't start with k equals 1, how to find that. So let's say we have, actually before I do that, I'm going to give you these rules, but I'll show you what the example is and I'll tell you why you want these rules. If we're looking at the summation here, from k equals 3 to 17 of k squared. So this is basically saying instead of k starting at 1, I'm going to plug in 3 wherever I see a k in this a sub k function. The thing is that this could get really tedious, right? Especially if I have to figure out a lot of different terms. Here I have to find 4 different terms and then sum it. That's not too bad. But there are some rules you might remember, some formulas that will help us find summations of certain terms. And the following gives us that list. So if you just have a summation from k equals 1 to n of just k, you can find out what the sum of all those terms are by looking at n times the quantity n plus 1, and that's all divided by 2. If we're looking at the summation, k equals 1 to n of k squared, we can find that by n times the quantity n plus 1 times the quantity 2n plus 1, and that's all divided by 6. Last one, if it's a cube that we're taking the summation of, so the summation of k cubed from k equals 1 to n, we can find that result by either looking at n squared times the quantity of n plus 1, and that is squared all over 4. Notice here, because this is multiplication, we can factor out the square from the numerator, because the rule says if it's multiplication, you just distribute it. There was summation, I couldn't do this. And then the denominator is 2 squared. So if we want, you could figure it out that way. Okay, so we want to use this one rule. So let's look at that following example. So again, that example, we're looking at the summation of k squared from 3 to 17. The problem with is that that rule I gave you is with k starting at 1. So let's manipulate it so we can figure this out by using this rule. We'll notice that this is the same thing. Let's look at the summation from k equals 1 to 17 of k squared. And then let's subtract off those first two terms. So we don't want the first term k sub, when k is 1, and we don't want it when k is 2. We want to start when k is 3. So if we subtract off the terms k equals 1 to 2, we would get back what we wanted here with k equal to 3. So now we can use this rule. So our n value in our case, n is equal to 17 for the first summation. And so I can do this rule. It says take n, which is 17, times 17 plus 1, which gives me 18, all times 2 times 17 plus 1. So 2 times 17 is 14, and 14 plus 1 is 15, all divided by 6, minus, so in this case over here, our n value, we're only summing up to 2. So using our formula again, that one wouldn't be too bad, right? Actually, probably would be faster for me to do it without that formula. So plugging in 2, or 1 for the square, I get 1 squared is 1, plus plugging in my 2 here, 2 squared is 4. So if you use this formula, you should get back for that piece 5. So this is equal to, so I notice on my top, my numerator, 17 times 18 times 15. Well, 18 has 6 in common with a denominator. So I can just simplify this a little bit. So I have 3 times 17 times 15. Which is equal to 765. Minus the quantity, which we said was 5. So this would be 760. Okay, so we were able to manipulate it. We needed that our initial value was starting at 1. So we were able to manipulate it when it didn't start out as 1 by using subtraction of the terms we didn't want in there.